Hi everyone, welcome to our session. So today we are going to be talking about the Bhagavad Gita. Today's topic is based on King Virat, who is also called Ecstasy by Paramhansa Yogananda Ji. Okay, so we will start with that. And before we do that, let's just understand. So the Pandavas spent the 13th year of their exile in the court of King Virat. And when I read the Bhagavad Gita by Paramhansa Yogananda Ji, he has a really interesting take on that. So I thought I would share that and also discuss the archers of discrimination, one of whom is King Virat. Okay, so welcome to our session again. So we're going to be talking about King Virat and the time that the Pandavas spent in his court. So here we go. So the idea of doing this particular series of the Bhagavad Gita is to help us understand the various characters and to help us understand how to bring those characters into our life and how to improve our spiritual practice by a series of stories that we perhaps already know. Okay, so it's a matter of what we know and kind of applying that. So this is going to be session 9. It's a book study and practice. It is largely based on God Talks with Arjuna by Paramhansa Yogananda Ji, shown here, and the various books on pranic healing by Master John Cox. Okay, here we go. So here's a picture of, it's a very beautiful painting actually, so I put it up here. It is a picture of King Virat, and this is a painting by Raja Ravi Varma. So we've used a couple of paintings by Raja Ravi Varma in this particular series. So according to Paramhansa Yogananda Ji, King Virat symbolizes samadhi or ecstasy. And so just wanted to explain a little bit on what is samadhi and ecstasy. I don't claim to have reached that state, but I am trying to get there, and I hope that all of us will get there together. So it is basically a temporary state of divine union in meditation. So sometimes when we meditate, some of us may feel that our body is, that we are being pulled out of our body, or we may feel very, very peaceful, or we may feel that we are in a different world, or sometimes we may feel that we are in the presence of, a greater energy, sometimes described as being in the presence of God. So although we do understand from Master Chok Hok Sui's books that to be directly in the presence of God may not be realistic, but given that, we also need to be aware that there are lots of energy transformers through which we can access the power of God and the love of God and the intelligence of God. So some of the figures that we see in our meditations could help us reach that level. Okay, so in the 13th year of exile that the Pandavas had to undergo, they had to they chose to spend the 13th year in the court of King Virat, right? And they took certain roles, so we'll just talk about that. So the question is, why is there this 13th year of exile? Was 12 years of just living properly not enough? Like they were living as ascetics. They were exiled from the kingdom and they were living as ascetics in ashrams. So, or in the forest or in various forests. So, wasn't that enough? Why the 13th year of disguise? So before we talk about that, let's just understand what is the 12 year of exile. So according to Paramhansa Yogananda Ji, once the material desires as habits, so material desires represented by Duryodhan and habits are represented by Dronacharya, take complete control of the body, it requires a cycle of 12 years to rid the bodily kingdom of the usurpers, which means that our bad habits and our, not bad habits necessarily, but our habits and our material desires require at least 12 years to be removed from our body. So our body is just not the physical body. Our body also has an etheric body, which is the energy sheath. Then we have the emotional sheath, which is also called the astral sheath. And we have the mental sheath, which is called the mental sheath. And beyond that, we have the causal body. Again, there are books by these names by Arthur Powell. So you can read that for more detail. These are also recommended readings by Master Chok Hok Sui. Okay, so it takes 12 years to rid ourselves of, material desires and habits. So then what happens is that after the 12 years, the qualities that we have developed need to be, before we can recover our kingdom, which is, again, all the bodies, we need to be able to exist in the world, use our senses, be with everything and everyone, But at the same time, we need to be in disguise, which means that, let's say, for example, if I'm eating something and I'm enjoying it, then I still need to be aware of my soul while I'm consuming this. So it's like I'm engaging my senses, but at the same time, while I'm engaging my senses, I am also in disguise, which means, you know, again, sometimes some of the greatest yogis are actually karma yogis, and they are living among us because they are the people who are, you know, very good people. They have very good characters. So there are people who will engage in, let's say, business or engage in any other field of business, but spiritually they are at a higher level in the sense that they're operating from their soul. So that is what makes them special people. And this process of exile, as it's called, is basically that period. That period where we are in samadhi, but while being in samadhi, which means while being in the state of soul awareness, we are also simultaneously doing physical things. Okay, so I'll explain that in a little bit. But before we get into that, let's also do the soul affirmation in this particular context, because we're talking about samadhi and meditation. So let's close our eyes, connect the tongue to the palate, inhale and exhale. Let's do the soul affirmation. I am that I am. I am not the body. I am not the emotions. I function through my body and I create emotions. I am not the thoughts. I create the thoughts. I am the soul. I am a spiritual being of divine intelligence, divine love, and divine power. I am one with my higher soul. I am that I am. I am one with the divine spark within me. I am a child of God. I am connected with God. I am one with God, and I am one with all. Inhale and exhale. Let's be aware of our physical body and let it go. Let's be aware of extracting our soul into our emotional body and then let that go as well. Let's extract ourselves into our mental body. Let that go. When the emotions, the thoughts, and the physical body are gone, what's left is the soul. Inhale and exhale. Be aware of the stillness, the peace, the ecstasy. And then gently open your eyes. And in this state, let's continue to understand what this means. So as Paramahansa Yogananda ji says, we should be able to hold on to the sense of, you know, discriminative qualities while functioning through the physical body and the senses. So what happens to the Pandavas? So the Pandavas, as we said, in the 13th year of exile, they have to hold on to their discriminative qualities while expressing themselves through the senses. So how does this happen? This happens, so let's start with Yudhishthir. So Yudhishthir is represented by ether, and he is one who speaks eloquently, and he's the one who helps King Virat build strategic alliances. He's also represented by the throat in the book God Talks with Arjuna. And his name is, I don't know if it's Kanka or Kanka, but that is what I found. So the idea is that when we speak, are we aware of ourselves as a soul when we are speaking? Okay. So what this means is, for example, let's say, for example, if we need to say something nice, then it's easy. But let's say, for example, we need to scold somebody. Then at that point, are we aware that we as the soul are calm? And the reason we are, let's say, scolding somebody is because that communication is something that they require, okay? So, you know, sometimes when I tell people, you know, let's not get angry, and it's like, are you kidding? Like, you know, this person behaves so badly. Like, how can you tell me not to get angry? So my point is, don't get angry from the inside. Be aware that you have anger within you. be aware that this person needs to be addressed in a certain way. But when we do it, let's be aware that we are the soul. So let's say, for example, if I'm scolding XYZ, it would be like, you know, I, the soul, I'm scolding this person because without this, this person is not going to understand, or this person has done wrong and therefore I need to scold them or reprimand them or whatever it is. So, you know, this gradually comes with practice, but of course, knowing what process it, to follow will help us to get there. Okay. So, okay. So the next one is Bhim, who is represented by the air element. Now, also, if you remember that Bhim takes the role of the cook in the palace of King Virat, and he also represents the Anahat Chakra or the heart chakra, and he is known as Ballav. So what came to my mind when I was going through making this presentation is that, you know, when we cook, for example, when we are cooking food for our family, do we really do it with the heart, or do we do it with, you know, okay, here's a chore. Oh God, I better cook fast. Oh God, I don't know if anyone's, you know, like, what do we say? Like, and also when we take the name of God, like we say, oh God, oh God, oh God, are we really thinking of God at that time? Or are we just saying, oh God, as a habit? Okay, because there's a big difference in saying, Lord God, help me, and saying, oh God, oh God, oh God. Okay, so I hope you understand what I'm trying to say. And so when we cook or when we do anything, are we able to do it with love? So for a lot of us who are, you know, right now at home, you know, we are in the COVID times, if we are cooking for our family, are we able to, you know, be aware of the soul, the role of the soul in this task that we have? We have this role as a cook, or, you know, as somebody who's helping the family be fed. And are we doing it with our heart? Okay, are we doing it with love? That's kind of what I take away from this understanding of Bhim, who represents the heart element, who represents the air element, as being the cook in the court of King Virat. Why King Virat? Because he represents ecstasy, samadhi. So that means we are, it's like achieving samadhi in the process of doing things, okay? Which is a good thing for most of us who are householders. So the next one is Arjun, who is represented by fire. So if you've seen fire, you would have seen how fire is, you know, sometimes it's dancing, right? Fire, dancing, fire. Like fire seems to always dance. So if you remember, in the court of King Virat, Arjun is the dance teacher, right? He is the dance teacher who teaches King Virat's daughter, Uttara, how to dance. And he lives as an Inak, which means he is neither male nor female. And the other thing that came to my mind when I was associating, you know, the dance, Arjun, fire, is that, you know, the planet is also like going through the dance of the sense of the sexes, right? There is the male and the female. And if you notice in most dance forms, there is a male aspect and a female aspect. And together the male aspect and the female aspect form, you know, create, you know, there is creation, there is Maya, there is all these things that come together and create the dance of life, right? So Arjun to me, represented by the fire aspect, also he's also represented by the solar plexus. So again, the solar plexus is something that can, you know, the solar plexus can make us really dance, right? If your solar plexus has never made you dance, you're lucky. But for most of us, our solar plexus can really make us dance. What I mean by that is that, you know, it's like pulled in different directions, you know, doing some crazy things. That's what our solar plexus allows us, well, makes us do sometimes, right? So if we bring in the Arjun aspect to that, and we teach our solar plexus to dance to the tune that we want it to dance to, which is to be courageous, but not be hurtful to people. Or if somebody hurts us, then to move that energy to the upper chakras and to enable us to forgive them, right? So again, you know, just trying to weave in the stories of the Mahabharata into the teachings of pranic healing and to understand how we can implement all of this. Okay, so his name was Brihanala while he was teaching. There's another interesting story about Arjun, but we'll just come to that. The next one we'll talk about is Nakul. So Nakul is represented by water, and he tends to the horses in King Virat's stable. So, you know, sometimes when we want to stop somebody, or, you know, when we see someone who is very pretty or very beautiful and we are attracted, you know, what comes to mind sometimes is like, hold your horses, right? Does that come to you? I don't know. That's what came to me when I was doing this. So hold your horses is basically what comes to my mind as something that happens when somebody is attracted to a person of, you know, sexually attracted, right? So Nakul actually tends to the horses in the court of King Virat. Again, he has to express himself while being aware that he is somebody else, right? So Nakul is actually a prince, and what he is doing is that he is behaving like a horse tender, or like a, you know, like a groomer or somebody who's grooming animals, and he has to do a really good job of it, knowing fully well that he is actually a, you know, a prince of a very high high bearing, right? So again, when we are performing a certain role, we need to perform that role properly. Now Nakul could not have you know, for example, taking care of the horses while still pretending to be, or, you know, showing himself to be a prince. So he has to conceal that side of him, and he has to do what needs to be done at that time. Okay. And his name at that point was Granthika. The next one we'll talk about is Shahdev. Shahdev is represented by the earth element, and he tends to the cows. So again, what comes to my mind again is that in India, for example, we used to believe that, you know, the cow can help fertilize the earth through cow dung and through other products. So these are just things that come to my mind, which I'm trying to like connect. So Shahdev, the earth element, tends to the cows, and the cows fertilize the earth. So that's kind of like the summary of what I wanted to share on this. And his name is Tantipal. Draupadi is kind of like a handmaiden, not exactly a handmaiden, but like she serves Sudeshna, the wife of King Virat, as Malini, the maker of garlands. And she's also called Sairandhari, which is a class of virtuous women who are usually found in the court. Okay, so what's the purpose of understanding these five Pandavas and Draupadi? So the purpose is that we know some of these stories. So now the point is, the next time when you think of cooking, I hope you'll think of the air element. I hope you'll think of the heart, and I hope you'll think of Bhim. And I hope you'll also be aware that, again, Bhim as a prince is taking his role as a cook very seriously and is doing a really good job at it. So that's what I mean. You know, we are all children of God. We are all very intelligent, very smart, all of that. But when we are doing the role that we have to take care of, at that point, we have to fit into the role. Okay. Just like I think Shakespeare also said, you know, just, I think something like, you know, all the world's a stage and all of us are just actors. Okay. Now, another interesting thing about King Virat is that his daughter was married to, Uttara was married to Abhimanyu. King Virat actually offered his daughter to Arjun, but Arjun said that since I have been her dance teacher, she's more like a daughter to me, so she can marry my son Abhimanyu. So what's important here is that their son, the son of Uttara and Abhimanyu, was actually the only surviving member of the Pandav family, who then ascended the throne after Yudhishthir. And his name was Parikshit. Parikshit means someone who has already gone through an examination. So someone who has been examined is called Parikshit. Okay. Okay, going back to King Virat, he was killed by Dronacharya. So Drona, if you remember, is habit. And what I understood here is that Virat, King Virat, whose name is ecstasy, can be killed by habit. So what I mean by this is, let's say, for example, if we are sitting down to, let's say, meditate, and we are meditating and we're having a great meditation, but it is our habit to eat food at a certain time, and we decided to meditate during our lunch hours, guess what's going to happen? Our habit of wanting to eat lunch is going to interfere with our samadhi, with our meditation, with our ecstasy. Okay, so that's what I kind of took away from the understanding that why is Virat killed by Drona? On the second day of the war, he killed Shailya's son, Madranjaya. So if you guys have any insight about this, let me know. I couldn't find any further thoughts on this. And in a different version, he is killed during a Kaurav attack. After Virat's death, Arjun became the king of King Virat's former kingdom, which is called Matsya. So King Virat was already quite aged, I guess after his passage, Arjun, who was the father of Abhimanyu, because Abhimanyu also died during the war, ascended the throne. Okay, so what we're going to do now is, let's be aware of the five Pandavas, and let's be aware of, so we're going to do a practice of inner reflection, which is the purpose of the first shloka of the Bhagavad Gita, as I understand it. So the shloka is Dhritarashtra Uvacha, Dharma Kshetre Kurukshetre Samaveta Yuyutsavaha Mamakam Pandavascheva Kim Kurvata O Sanjayaha. So we're going to do some inner reflection. Let's be aware of whatever ecstasy means to us, Okay, what does ecstasy, what does samadhi mean to us? And let us be aware of something that we have been able to do or we want to do while being in the state of samadhi, which means that, let's say, for example, once we are doing this meditation, for example, when we do the meditation, can we be aware of ourselves as a soul doing this meditation? What are the other things about inner reflections? We can think of something that we did today. So it's, you know, went from the time that we woke up in the morning. What did we do? How did we behave? Is there something that we can change? Is there something that we can change? Is there some behavior that we indulged in that perhaps wasn't the best in that situation? So can we as a soul erase that particular activity, erase that particular behavior, and let's replace it with the right behavior, the correct behavior. So let's say, for example, there were some unkind words we spoke to somebody because they did something wrong. So could we have kind of withdrawn into the soul and still said what we had to say? Perhaps with some kindness, perhaps with some awareness that everybody makes mistakes. This person also tried to do their best. Perhaps there was a mistake. Could we have taken a more nurturing approach and still conveyed what we needed to convey, but in a more gentle way? Let's go through our day from morning till about 4 o'clock today. What did we do that we could perhaps change? Inhale and exhale. So visualize ourselves doing the same action, but in the right way, with the right thoughts, with the right words, and the right actions. Just one thing. Inhale and exhale. Let's keep our eyes closed. In this state of stillness, we will move on to the meditation. Now, it's also important to also think of what we did right. So I'm sorry we missed that step, but let's do that now. Let's also go through our day and think of a couple of things that we did well. We did things right. It's important for us to also focus on what we do right. So let's think of some things that we did right. Let's be aware of ourselves. We are all growing. We are all children of God. We all make mistakes. Inhale and exhale. Let us invoke to the Supreme God, Divine Father, Divine Mother. We thank you for your priceless blessings, for divine light, divine love, divine guidance, divine love, mercy, inner healing, physical healing. Thank you for the inner strength to practice regularly. Thank you for your divine help and protection, for illumination, abundance, and prosperity. We thank you. Let's raise our hands in blessing position. Let's be aware that all of us here have some spiritual targets. Let's bless everyone's spiritual target. Let's bless everyone's health target, relationship target, and financial target. By the law of karma, we expect that whatever blessings we are giving to everybody on the group will come back to us many, many, many times. Inhale and exhale. Let's also be aware that the purpose of doing things as a soul, if from what I've understood from the book, God Talks with Arjuna, is that when we undertake an action and we do it as the soul, what happens is that we don't necessarily incur any negative karma, any karma associated with it. So let's say, for example, if we are taking an action and we are doing it as a soul and we are aware at that moment that we are doing it as a soul, you know, as my role as a mother, as my role as a pranic healing instructor, in my role as a healer, I am doing this. So I am doing this to somebody or as a soul. So when we do things as a soul, then it is my understanding based on my reading of God Talks with Arjuna that we don't incur any further karma. So that's the purpose of withdrawing ourselves and operating as a soul. So I hope you find that useful. Let's also bless the entire planet that is affected by the COVID-19 virus. May the Buddha Kuan Yin, with her divine compassionate purifying light, extract, externalize, and raise to higher vibrations all negativity associated with the coronavirus. May the Lords of Karma help us to learn our lessons. Let's bless the entire planet, our countries, our states, our cities, our homes, our workplace, with divine light in the form of guidance, divine love in the form of providing for everyone, financial security, good relations, and divine intelligence and divine power. Divine power is the goodwill and the will to do good. Inhale and exhale. Let's bless our projects. Let's bless anyone who has asked us for blessings. Remember, we are channels of blessings. We are instruments by which we can enable the blessings to flow from the Supreme God through ourselves to other people. Okay, let's massage our face, our scalp, shoulders, chest, the back, the hips, the thighs. Just wake up the entire body, come back into the body. Reflection, which is one of the teachings of Master Chokok Sui, that when we do inner reflection and that when we replace our patterns with other things that we think we can do, then gradually what happens is that it changes the way we think. And when we are in that situation again, then automatically the mind and the body and the emotions will do what is, a preferred behavioral pattern. So gradually we're going to work on this. And thank you so much for joining, and we'll see you soon. If you haven't subscribed already, do subscribe to our YouTube channel so that you'll be notified whenever there is another upload. Thanks. Bye.